from this project? What is the invaluable experience we accumulated? The first key word is cooperation and partnership. The requirements for applying included such possibilities to apply as partners, and we did that by inviting two smaller municipalities. We also invited some NGOs from the Roma community, the schools in the village in Pobeda and Medie, and these are our partners. Together we implemented the project. Other partners were addressed during the before the break. There were partnerships built on all levels, starting with the fact that three ministries monitored the program, the project: the Ministry of Labor, of Education, and of Health. It would have not been possible for the project to succeed if the ministries were not communicating well. We also partnered with the project management unit. We had meetings. We created partnerships, and this is the great contribution of this program, because it helped us. It taught us how to build partnerships. Because here in Bulgaria we have difficulties somehow to unite efforts and work together. There were also partnerships within the project itself, within the various areas, the area of education, of healthcare, of culture, social services. So there were partnerships on horizontal and vertical level, and this was invaluable. Another important thing happening under the project was that it was well targeted, it was tailored. There wasn't an all one size fits all approach. How it worked in Burgas. Burgas is different from Montana or Ruse or Sliven. That's why our project was different from your projects, although there are many common things. When we started with our project, we identified the needs. With Mrs. Butushanska, we sat down to examine the results of the training of students or education of school children in the neighborhood of mainly Roma origin. And we felt ashamed that our school holds the very last place in all classifications regarding state exams, any type of exam. We looked for the reasons. Well, it appeared that the school was small, there is no capacity there to provide the preschooling, and also there is no kindergarten in the neighborhood. In the school there was no space to organize the full day education, and this was the only school in Burgas where no training outside the regular hours would be offered. And we understood that things must be changed in order to change the results. So we needed to address the issue of the building, the very infrastructure. And that's what happened. Thanks to the support of the project, the building became wonderful. When we started doing it, everybody said, well, in a year from now, this building would be spot, nothing would look like this, nobody would preserve it. Well, it's been there for 3 years now, and it looks wonderful. This is one of the cleanest and well-maintained schools in Burgas. And not because this is a good and new building in the neighborhood, but because it turned into a home. And we all know that home is made of people, made up of people. The building itself is important, but if there are no people there who can turn it into a home, into a school, it would never be preserved. And that's why the community looks after this building, because their children are educated there. There are events, celebrations, open classes, various services are offered there, not only educational but also social and health services. They can go there at any time and they will find an open door. That's why this school turned into a center, community center. As a deputy mayor of education, I'm very happy. Most happy are the achievements of our students. Mrs. Botushanska just mentioned to me that from the very last place in all classifications, now 59% of the students from this school cover the state educational requirements. This is amazing. But it would not have been possible without the support of the Bulgarian Swiss cooperation program and the ZOF project. Something else that I consider as a contribution of the project, compared to many other operational programs that we have been implementing, is that the so-called investment measures were combined with the so-called soft measures. Because there are programs that support only investments, others that support only soft measures. Sometimes there is a mismatch between programs because the different people who manage them. But here a balance was achieved. The infrastructure was designed in a way to offer in the best possible way the soft measures and services that we planned for. Something else very important in this program was that the people administering the program, Irina and Lily, are not dogmatic. Because in many cases, managing authorities would come over to find irregularities, to punish us, to make financial adjustments. It was not like this in this case. The team would come over to help us, to assist us. The funds, the idea was for the funds to be used in the most efficient way with the highest results. I would never forget that there was a small part of funding left after the construction of the building. So we sat down at the table and they asked us, what does the school need most? And we decided that it will be very good for the children to have an open-air gym. And this is now the most frequented place. It is used even now in the summer. So this was really a very efficient use of funding. Excuse me if I'm too emotional, especially for a deputy mayor, but I assume that everyone in the hall considers this project also from the standpoint of emotions. I'm very grateful to my team, to Maggie, Jenny, Mrs. Botushanska, Mitko, the mediators. I see them all in the hall, because once again I would underline, without people nothing can happen. Also I would like to thank Lily and Irina, because they were here all the time. They supported us, they endorsed us. I'm grateful to everyone who contributed to this program, making it possible. I'm sure that the lessons learned is something that we will carry with us forever. And another good thing is that we all have our contact information, and if we encounter problems with any other project, we know who we can call, how, and I'm sure that we'll receive some useful advice, and we will do the same. I now like to wish you lots of energy and courage. Put your heart in what you're doing so that you achieve visible results, just as the children we saw in front of us today. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Заслуженный аплодисмент.
Well-deserved applause for Mrs. Ananieva, but that's the right way to reach the people. And to continue with the topic of education, we'll start with a video film regarding how work is done with children in several regions. The Swiss project, I think, gives us an impetus forward. I'm not Todorova, part of the Bulgarian Swiss project. I'm a teacher of sports, and these are the girls with whom we train. For 2 years we've been working under the Bulgarian Swiss project. 28 children from the first to the fourth grades. We paint, draw, do origami. Parents are also involved, just as their elderly or younger siblings. Everything we do is very interesting for them. We created a school for parents, also a school for children who are lagging behind, also Sunday schools. And thanks to the work with the children and parents, many of the children who are at the risk of dropping out are now regular school goers. The branch of this kindergarten was founded in October 2016 under the Swiss program for integration of Roma and other vulnerable communities. We have two groups of 20 children each. The kindergarten was my long-suffered dream. I think that if you want an institution to be respected, it should look in the right way as well. I fought hard, and I was able to persuade everybody in my dream. In my career in the Malko Trnovo municipality, this will be the symbol of my presence here.
Ludna kanala za reći se čuti, kada kanala za reći se čuti, kada kanala za reći se čuti.
Така, за да води.
Now I'm going to invite Ilko Yordanov, who is an expert under the ZOFP program. He will be the co-moderator of this panel. It is very easy to participate in the discussion. Just raise your hand and you will be given a microphone. So, Ilko, it's you now. Good afternoon, everyone. Programs ZOFF do not have only this inspiring effect for the local communities, for the education and health, and for the overall development, but also they're a fertile soil to generate ideas and improvements in all other regions. We know that the key thing to change education is governance, of course, governance of school communities, also governance of staff, qualifications, raising the qualifications. The second thing is funding. And last but not least, interaction with the local communities, development of links between the educational establishment and the parents and the communities, creating a partnership community. For each of these key aspects, the ZOFF program contributed a lot. In this panel dedicated to education, we have the opportunity to address all these issues. Allow me first to invite, once again from Burgas, Mrs. Radostina Botushanska, principal of secondary school in the neighborhood of Pobeda. Mrs. Botushanska is a leader of a future innovative school, because that's what we expect of Hristo Botev School. We'll hear what schools need to be encouraged to become innovative. I'm also going to invite the principal of the kindergarten Nadezhda, Mrs. Valeva from Sliven. We have met her earlier. She is the principal of the kindergarten in one of the most difficult communities, the teacher of Little Jesus. Now, Mrs. Tevka Simeonova from the municipality of Plovdiv, a pedagogue and an administrator in the municipality, but she spent her whole professional experience in the eastern region of, or eastern part of Plovdiv, where the Stolypinovo neighborhood is located. Now let's applaud Maya Mikhailova from the partner in Ruse. Maya is an economist, but also a very good psychologist, and we are going to rely on her expertise a lot. Maya is also one of the few examples of people who would turn their back to Sofia and go back to the countryside, and she's been achieving great results in Ruse under the ZOFF program. And now I'm inviting Mitko Doku from the regional Roma Union in Burgas. If you're looking for a good partner for the region of Burgas in the area of Roma integration, you must reach out for Mitko Dokov, because he represents the civil sector. He is also a social entrepreneur and an entrepreneur in general. And last but not least, I'm going to invite one more representative of a municipality, Alexander Gerasimov, the coordinator for education of Montana municipality. What can I tell you about him? Minister Vučev has been the person that traveled most to the municipalities, and he did it because he wanted to learn from the municipalities. And Sasha Gerasimov is one of the persons that the minister learned a lot. And he is also a mathematician, and he is passionate about math. So I'll ask him to start by telling us what are the main results of the ZOF program in Montana. As a mathematician, can you tell us what is there behind the number?
Да, благодаря.
Thank you. You made me blush almost. As this is the format and this is your question, let me say about some of our achievements that we have implemented in the ZOF program. So the key word here is interaction. As the remaining five municipalities have, we have gone through the first phase of concept presentation and project proposal making. It was assigned to an independent team. And I decided that my job was done. I felt calm, but I was very wrong, because what the colleagues did when we read the project proposal, a long list of activities, but when you consider how it can be implemented, it all was undermined. And this is when Ms. Fayon joined the PMU, and we had to resolve the issue of what to do next. And quite unexpectedly for me, because we have good experience in project implementation, I honestly expected that this project would fail. I did not imagine, I could not fathom that we would be given so much freedom, that we would have the chance to be pragmatic, to be focused, to be specific in order to achieve a success. So the key word in our achievement is interaction and cooperation between the institutions that we involved. We worked with six educational facilities, two kindergartens and four schools, with an NGO. A cultural center in the Roma neighborhood. I'd like to thank its chairperson, because it really helped us a lot. In the educational module, we decided that we had to do something valuable and well needed. And this big thing was a new building for the kindergarten in the Kusharny neighborhood, which was a problem to be resolved. So as unfathomable as it looked, it came through thanks to this interaction and understanding, and to the freedom given to us, and to the pragmaticism that we enjoyed. And I would like to thank the PMU from the bottom of my heart. In other projects, this couldn't have been possible. We talked a while ago with other colleagues. This is the major advantage of this project, that we were doing only what's necessary. we'll talk about freedom and decentralization given to municipalities and educational facilities. Thank you, Sasha, for the good example and for the two emphases and for the keywords, interaction and cooperation. What about you, Butushanska? What are the keywords for your success? I will have to repeat the same keyword, interaction. Everything in our project, in our municipality, came through the way it was supposed to. I would like to thank the leadership of the Burgas municipality for the support. Our school is located in a very difficult neighborhood. Most of the people present have visited it. It was the first school constructed under the Swiss, Bulgarian-Swiss program. So I'll repeat, I'll stand firmly behind the words cooperation and interaction, but let me also emphasize on another keyword, institutionalization. I've worked on many programs. So if this was not the case, I don't think we would have been successful. We worked on FAR projects, on many other programs, but this is what's achieved in the best possible way, because the municipality can actually see the beneficiaries, and this is why it can run the project so well. And then we are given the chance to work and do what's needed in order to create a learning environment and win over the parents to our cause as well as the teachers that had to be motivated, because as our deputy mayor said, without the teachers, nothing could be accomplished. We had our good partnerships with the Burgas municipality and also with our partners from the other entities. This is why we were successful. Thank you. I would like to express my deep gratitude to our partners that made it possible to have this project be so successful. Thank you, Lily. Thank you, Irina. Personally, as a leader of our organization, for us, this was a mission. To give education, to offer education to our people, because education is at the core of any society. So this is why we benefited from the chances given by this project. This project gave us a wonderful, brilliant model. And my desire is for this to continue, because we saw our gaps, we saw our errors, but we corrected them as we went, and I am sure we will continue working like that. I would like that the integrated measures should cover other areas such as employment, housing, apart from healthcare and education, because if you have nowhere to live, you can't be healthy. If you don't work, you can't send your children to school. If you're not educated, you can't work. It's a chain of events, and if there is a gap, it will all tumble down. This is why I believe that all these measures should run in parallel in order to have good results in all spheres. And the best lesson we've learned from this project is that if we didn't work as a good team of partners, it would be very difficult. So everybody should know their place and their strengths. The teachers, the parents, the administration. So the team should work hard in synchrony. If that without team spirit, we will not move on. And my desire is for these measures to be working in parallel. Thank you. Now let's hear the other colleagues on my right to talk about their accomplishments. Sliven, there is a question from the floor. As Mikhail announced, we wanted to hear first the introductory remarks of the panelists, and then I insist on receiving questions from the audience. And then we'll hear. Let us hear the introductory remarks. Let me first express my gratitude. We now have a beautiful new kindergarten in a spacious and a well-lit building. We had the pleasure of accommodating it with kids, with their smiles and songs. We started with the parents, because without them we couldn't bring the children to our kindergarten. The parents live in the Nadezhda neighborhood, and this is the first educational facility in this neighborhood. Most of the inhabitants of this neighborhood had never been included in educational facility, or they dropped out soon afterwards. This is why we tried in a very accessible and transparent way to show them what was happening in a kindergarten and what kindergarten was all about, even before it was launched. So we first invited all the people interested in enrollment to meet the team, the management, and myself, and then together, sing, dance, draw. And we were quite impressed that some of the parents saw children's books for the first time, they played games for the first time, and they drew pictures for the first time, and they were very happy that this was offered to their children. As soon as our actual activity started, this interaction continued. We are extremely accessible and transparent, and we allow parents to come up to us, to ask us questions about their kids, to be involved in the environment, which is accessible and encouraging. And in this way, parents could be closer to the team of kindergarten trainers, but also closer to their kids. I'm grateful that we filled out the capacity of our kindergarten, and now we have enrolled children for the two nursery groups and to the for the four kindergarten groups. There are people on the children on the waiting list, and this all was achieved with the support of all institutions in the city, to the ZOF program and to its partners, to the communication that we had with different cities and organizations, with the experts from the Sliven municipality, with the NGOs, and we are all grateful to them. It was an extremely helpful exercise. Could you remind us of one of the good practices under ZOF and the exchange between municipalities, between and among project locations, Montana and Plovdiv, Shuman and Ruse? Now let's hear Maya about the recipe for success.
Thank you, Ms. Voleva, that a month ago you invited us with a team from the Bulgarian-Romanian Institute of Mediation to present our experience to this beautiful kindergarten. As I see it, what was crucial is that we should share, we should build on it, draw on it, and learn from what the others are doing, so that together we can get better in our work to the best benefit of the vulnerable groups. What happened in Ruse? The project there enjoyed the widest partnerships among all the projects under the ZOF program. At the beginning, it was difficult to coordinate our efforts, but our good intentions and our experience and willingness to help each other and be creative in reaching out to the target groups. Our NGO worked in four municipalities under the ZOF program: Ruse, Vetovo, Borovo, and Ivanovo. And he worked in nine schools there. What we learned there was that although it's a small region, the problems vary, and we should be flexible to offer different solutions to different problems, and in order to meet the individual needs of the citizens living there. And as a result, I can conclude that our results were not, our efforts were not in vain. It was not easy. We had our ups and downs, but after four full school years, and we had meetings with principals and the mayors, we could shake hands and congratulate ourselves on the good work done. This is what happened in the Beto municipality, where we are continuing to work with the two schools that we worked with under the ZOF program, the primary school and the secondary school. I hope that our achievements will continue to be followed in order to offer good quality service to those that need it the most, the future of our nation, children. Thank you. I think we must emphasize the contribution of the partners from Ruse for the international exchange with Romania, which was highly appreciated by all participants, and which is a good example of sharing our achievements in order to grow together. Let's hear briefly about the achievements in Plovdiv from Ms. Simeonova. Good afternoon. I heard several times that the project is ending. We'll say goodbye, but we'll stay in touch. We are a community drawn together thanks to the Bulgarian-Swiss cooperation program. We are a community of same thinkers that invested support, initiation. So this resource should be used. Local governance, the local government should make sure that these policies become sustainable, because we have blazed the trail for them. I think this is important, and this is essential for our team as a result of all the efforts of the Bulgarian-Swiss cooperation program. This is what we should count on, and this is what we should preserve, communications, because this will be to the best interest of all of us. When we compare how we will do in the future, because we are going to have local elections, and each candidate is going to have programs, political programs, rather than have something like the public debate for policy making. I'd like to express my deep thanks to Irina and Lily as the representatives of the PMU, because we were given the liberty to implement policies through cooperation. We didn't have this before, and I'm saying this openly. I thank my team in Plovdiv. We have a very close-knit team with a vision for future activities that the Bulgarian-Swiss program may contribute in the future, and I think we are coming forward. What happened in Plovdiv? The most important achievement was that we now have a wonderful sports educational center in Stolypinovo. And nothing was demolished. I think one of my achievements as an expert on education in the region was a decision of the municipal council of 8 years ago to bring down a wing of a school. But I think now I've learned my lesson, and we should be building rather than demolishing. And it's a wonderful center that we have now, and it is fully utilized. And there is a partnership between the two school principals to use that. So this facility is full of life, and this is our major achievement. And also we had very helpful practices for additional Bulgarian language classes. We have groups in sports, and they are part of the group of rhythmical gymnastics project. How many of these kids had the chance to practice gymnastics? And we broke the encapsulation of this community that was consolidated within the neighborhood, who fears to leave. These kids now were going out to attend concerts or musicals, ballet performances, theater performances, and something extremely innovative. Our partner Plovdiv 2019 Plovdiv being the European culture of Europe. So do come when you have the chance to attend our beautiful events and beautiful Plovdiv, the seventh most ancient city in Europe. You will be fascinated. These children of 10 groups visited all performances for kids. First, they met the orchestra, then they went to the changing rooms, to the dressing rooms. They then tried out the costumes and then attended the performance. Then they drew pictures at events, drawing events. So this was the most beautiful project I've experienced, I've witnessed. So we have vision for the future, and we are grateful for that. Thank you.
Понеже става дума за визия за.
As we are talking about the vision about the future, you also mentioned elections. I promise that we'll be talking based on information from the participants in the forum regarding the key challenges. And I'll ask Boyan Zakhariev now to present them in brief. And after that, we'll start with the discussion. Thank you. I'm grateful to these almost 80 people who filled in the questionnaire elaborated by the ZOF team. I think this is very interesting, both for education and for health care. We asked two questions for education and two for healthcare. The first one being the most important problems in the respective area, and the second regarding the key, sometimes conflicting and difficult policies for education. 7 out of 10 respondents said that poverty and a low level of parental education is the biggest problem in the education of vulnerable groups. Then irregular school going, 6 out of 10 respondents consider this as a significant problem. 5 in 10 consider school dropping out as a huge problem. Then bad knowledge of Bulgarian language, insufficient kindergarten coverage, a lack of connection between education and labor market, and some others. Ilko asked me to come up with some significant questions based on these results. Well, first, which of these fell under the scope of the ZOF program, which are very difficult? Well, poverty and low education of parents, for example. I'm sure that the analyzers from PISA will agree, because they say that the social status in Bulgaria is the main cause for bad performance, poor performance. Of course, this is a very sad conclusion, because regarding the children who are right now joining the education system, kindergartens, what we can do in order to change the situation regarding poverty and low parental education? Well, obviously the ZOF program did not cover all these issues, although you all report on good results today. Then probably based on solving only one problem without solving all problems, something can still be achieved. Well, that's a kind of challenging question to all of you. Now, congratulations to the ZOF team because for their courage to ask this question. The question regarding segregation and desegregation. The question was, do you support the idea of Roma children studying in desegregated schools, or rather improving the conditions in the schools in the Roma communities? Well, 6 in 10 respondents supported the first option. This is a very complicated issue. For some years, there was a policy of not funding segregated schools. I think that this was not a good policy, but however, EU documents also did not recommend usage of EU funds that may lead to increased segregation. So this is an interesting issue. I myself cannot say that I have the answer to it. So it will be interesting to see how you all are going to address this. Thank you, Bujan. Thank you for the challenging questions. I would only add that some of the respondents, in fact, refused to answer this last question because there are numerous, many considerations to be accounted for. But still, we wanted to see what the majority of respondents think. Let's see again the results regarding poverty. Two-thirds of respondents say that poverty and low parental education are the key challenges. Well, this question, in fact, combines two issues, poverty and low parental education. As people involved in integration issues, we know that there is close connection between poverty and low education. As regards parental education, because research and studies show 50% of the Roma with secondary education, at least one of the parents also graduated from secondary school or even higher level of education, or tried to graduate higher education. Now I'm going to ask Mitko Doku, because they work with difficult parents, as we say. So what can help to motivate them to study, increase their own education and send their children to schools? Well, this is one of the most difficult tasks, and I base my answer on my experience. 8 or 9 years ago, a project that was administered by the municipality and funded. It was a small project, about 10,000 lev probably, but it still gives good results. It is very difficult to work with poor and illiterate people. It is always difficult to work in such a community. There are always fears. Uh, when we encounter the real situation in the community, encountering the poverty and illiteracy of parents, we are left helpless, as if we try to explain how important education is, that this is the future. If you are, if you have graduated the 8th grade, for example, you will get higher remuneration, but they would look through us. They tell us, well, we are hungry and you want us to go to school. Can you imagine a hungry child sitting on a desk and studying? Well, you can ask teachers. In the morning, children would they would go out and rummage the containers, looking for food. But we can do many things if we work in teams, in partnerships. Otherwise, nothing can happen. The municipality, the institution, and the people of the community, when they speak the same language, results can be achieved. With this project, over several months, we succeeded in attracting, convincing girls to graduate secondary school. 12 girls. This is unbelievable, amazing girls in secondary school. There was a question from the audience, somebody told me. The microphone is not working. While listening to everyone, I understood and I felt the positive energy of all these people. And one of the most important impressions I felt, and a specific feature of the Swiss project, was that obligatory inclusion of Roma organizations and young Romas in the implementation of the project. This turned them not just in stakeholders, but also owners of the project, in the same way that the other stakeholders felt, even to a greater extent. Why so? Well, because that's where their children would go, and the children from their community. The project provided room for creativity, for friendship, for hope. And it provided a channel to do something good for the community, and show this to the others and lead them in this direction. And thanks to Mitko and his team, because they were the first with such achievements. And I wanted to ask him to tell him about the motivation. He tried. The reality is, this desire of everyone involved to do the best possible thing, and based on this, to enjoy the love amongst us. I saw this in Burgas, in Schumann, in Sredec, in Montana, everywhere. Mitko was a real inspiring factor. Mitko, for a brief comment. Well, I said It is difficult, but for us as a team, because we've known one another for 15, 20 years almost, the team, our team is well trained, and the community has many other social needs, health, employment, marriage, divorce, everything would go through us, everyone that needs support. So our team is well prepared, knowledgeable and able. But trying to motivate the people is always difficult. That's why it is important to offer a package of services. Our mediators, our assistants help. So prepared and knowledgeable people who come from the community play a very important role. Mrs. Pencher. The microphone is not working. Just to add something about the Schumann model, because when we started under the SOF program, we didn't have the team that you said you had, but thanks to Mrs. Fayon and the coordination of education, the head of the program, because we chose a kindergarten and a school in a village and the Schumann University as partners, we already have a team in place. And the kindergarten is located in the beginning of the, on the road, in the beginning of, from Sofia to Schumann, in the beginning of Schumann. So this is now a really child's paradise. There is a playground, wonderful, colorful, and all this thanks to the 28 months of work. But first, the creation of a team, some professionals from Schumann University, trained the pedagogical and non-pedagogical staff of both the kindergarten and the school. And over these 28 months, teachers, parents, and children would twice a month meet together, go out, be involved in some creative work. We have organized joint sports events, extremely entertaining, and all this thanks to the Bulgarian-Swiss program. They have a question. Please be brief. I would like to attract your attention to the second slide. A very interesting result. Of course, it always matters who we are asking, because when we ask questions in the same, in the format that we see in this hall, 60-40% ratio is normal. But if we ask this question to 100 parents, maybe the results will be very different. And if we ask this question to 100 parents from the Nadezhda neighborhood, the results will be completely different. So this needs to be checked. But do you have a question to the panelists? Well, this is both the question and a comment. Well, in Sliven, this is the biggest challenge, because it needs to be proved that a kindergarten located close to the neighborhood can bring about great results? Question maybe to Mrs. Valeva, and I would like to ask something. Is Nadezhda or hope kindergarten be also hope for the neighborhood, hope for changing the neighborhood? I personally also think that there are various and diverse standpoints on this question. But as regards Nadezhda neighborhood in Slivent, I think this is a good option. I think it is difficult for people who have not, who have never left the neighborhood, to be put in a completely different environment. It will be impossible for them to feel well, to feel calm about their children. Our kindergarten is close to them, close to the community, not only in terms of location, but also close to their hearts as parents. We give them opportunity to be close to their parents. So that's my opinion. Back to the previous question. The good side of the ZOF program was that it continued for 3 years. 3 years is not a short period of time. Of course, it is not sufficient to solve all problems. I think that there must be a systemic, ongoing work to solve the problems of the extremely marginalized families for whom poverty and lack of parental education is so closely tied that this kind of knot cannot be cut. Yes, there are some best examples. When systemic work with a 5-member family would give possible positive results. This was in the Kosharnik neighborhood. Both parents were illiterate, but right now the children, elder finished the 5th grade, the second the 1st grade. This systemic work made it possible for them to study in regular school in Sliven, so the in Montana, I'm sorry. And what happened was that the elderly daughter, in fact, helped her mother start reading and writing. It cannot work with small projects and and systemic work, because what is needed is efforts, joint efforts on all levels. And that's how positive results will be achieved.
Speaking of systemic work, Ms. Simeonova, at the end of her introduction, mentioned that she had ideas herself on how the educational mediator could be utilized most effectively. Thanks to the ZOF's experience on extracurricular activities and improvement of curricula for learning Bulgarian language, how can this experience be transformed into specific policies for improvement of
integration. If you allow me to go back to the slide on desegregation. Different communities in different areas of Bulgaria differ considerably. Statistically, differences will appear. I'm speaking of Stolypinovo in Plovdiv. We had a three-year project by an organization. It was completed 3 years ago with very negative results. At the beginning, everybody was very enthusiastic, very good organization with transport services, but then it all subsided. Parents didn't want their kids to go to different schools downtown or to other neighborhoods because they do not feel comfortable. They, despite the fact that there were supportive teachers accompanying small kids. Let's consider the new processes that we have. Migration. A lot of parents travel all over the world and they enroll their children in local schools. They come back speaking foreign languages, German, English or French, but not speaking Bulgarian. They had other contacts with other kinds of school systems. And the problem of having a better quality school education is to invest in there in the school infrastructure, in extracurricular activities and additional classes in Bulgarian language and the forms that they will allow, that will allow such children to participate in the cultural and social life of the city. So small scale projects, small steps, but persistent quality. I can see that Ms. Chufekcheva is here. I fully agree with her because we met 10 days ago at another forum. Integration is related to inclusion, and I fully agree, because inclusion means to account for the cultural identity of this group of people and include it to the place where this group socializes without without ignoring their cultural identity. So I agree, I like inclusion better than integration. I wanted to go back to winning the trust of this community because we have all agreed that the communication with them was discontinued time ago. This is now why we acknowledge how important early childhood development is, education and health care, because these people are illiterate, most of them, or have very poor education. So one meeting, one counseling are ineffective. We need to work systemically. And this is what we did under the ZOF program over the years. For school years, we worked closely for months on end with a single parent, with a single child, with a single family who failed to understand why it is so important for a child to go to school every day. The child didn't feel like it every day. They had some other stuff to do, and school is way behind in the system of values in a family. And allow me, it's very hard for an illiterate parent to realize how a child can be motivated to go to school regularly and that school brings future. So there is a lot of work to be done and it takes time. Our achievements are solid, but they should be made sustainable if we want to win over the trust of our beneficiaries. And I'd like to also express my gratitude to the PMU team and all our partners, because they are our friends that we will count on in the future. We have only five minutes. a comment from Ms. Botushanska and another question from Georgi. He is an educational mediator. I would like to say something about the 40% in favor of segregation. So schools in the neighborhoods should be improved, and only then could we achieve results. I've worked since 1994 in this school. I've been through all the stages. I've seen it all. What has happened thanks to the support given by the Zof program and by the Plovdiv municipality and by the Burgas municipality. And let me tell you now that now there are examinations for enrollment. These were the children under the new chance for success. So several programs complement each other. They were first in grade 1, then in grade 5, and now they have to take examinations. So these people want their kids to study in our school in grade 7, and they will continue in VET, and our parents will continue to push their kids to go to school regularly. Thank you. Georgi can also be proud of the fact that he was able to motivate parents to enroll their kids. Their kids in higher grades. Yes, this is what I had in mind. Our parents, the parents we work with, need not only primary education but also secondary education. I have worked with parents. One of the parents I've worked with decided to study medicine. So my question is, to what extent educational mediators are accessible and how easily they are trusted by the community? Thank you for this question. There is somewhat distorted information about the essence of mediation. No matter if it's an educational or health mediator, we know what it means. The mediator is the bridge between the authorities and the community. How close they are, because this is our question, our mediators have been with us since 2004 under an HIV AIDS prevention program. Our team includes not only Roma but Bulgarians too. We have a multi-ethnic team. There's a Bulgarian member, and she has been invited to every single house, to every single family in our neighborhood, and she has always enjoys the respect of our community. So it is up to the mediator to break the ice, to bring down all barriers, to build trust. From there on, it's easy. Why it's easy with us? Because we've enjoyed the trust over the years, not only with the community, but with the authorities as well. And then, from there on, it's not so difficult. Mitko is right. And let me respond. If the educational mediator is not accessible, then he or she should look for another occupation. In Plovdiv, we've worked under the project since 2017, and we used to work with educational mediators under another project from the beginning of 2016. So 90% of the job description of the educational mediator was proposed by us based on our experience, So educational mediators are an extremely important entity. I'm surprised they're not so popular everywhere. Maybe you haven't had the chance to come across the right person, because the educational mediator is the future. And let me quote a figure here. Our educational mediators managed for 2 years only, after having visited 620 houses, to bring 250 kids back to school without referring to decree number 100. So they are essential, they are a crucial entity. And one more thing for 30 seconds. Education is crucial for the future with its good infrastructure, but also with the human resources. And one last example, in our new educational center, we heard the Moonlight Sonata played on a synthesizer. So the music teacher realized that this kid was talented, and she worked for 2 months with this child only, and we heard this beautiful performance. We were surprised that this was a kid learning the piano for 2 months only. So it's up to the teacher, after all. Time's up. Sorry, we have to wrap up. Let me thank all the panelists for their contribution and experience shared, and for the challenges. And let me say what my take-home message from this panel is. Programs such as ZOV and others are the good examples. They generate good initiatives. We create possibilities for the municipalities to use the liberty to hire educational mediators and healthy mediators. We generate ideas for better teaching Bulgarian in schools where the children do not speak it as a mother tongue. But we need an institutional change, which takes a longer time. And in the meantime, we should be able to influence the policies of the Ministry of Education to develop such curricula and syllabi where there are special needs to be to adequately meet their needs through their curricula and textbooks, just as the infrastructure built under the ZOV program corresponds to their needs. Thank you, and see you soon.
Благодаря на всички.
Thank you. 15 minutes break before the second panel, which is as important as this one, as it is dedicated to healthcare.
Thank you.
И така, ще ви помогна.
Please, everybody who is still outside, come back to the conference hall, because we are now going to continue with one last and very important panel dedicated to healthcare. We'll introduce the topic with a short, brief video material with health experts and health mediators from Plovdiv and Zvezdets. The health center was launched 2 months ago, and we were able to start with the soft measures and activities under the project relating medical checkups and work with the target groups as early as April 2017. With the launching of the project. In this neighborhood, people would marry and give birth at an early age. So some of my patients, well, their mothers have been patients of mine, and now their children. We have all equipment necessary for medical checkups, everything that is needed to provide good services to pregnant women. My name is Diana Ivanova from Malko Trnovo. I work as a health mediator. I started in 2016. The health mediator is a facilitator, intermediary between the institutions and the community. But when you encounter specific cases, you may become an interpreter and translator, psychologist, social worker. My name is Mariana Kokorkova. I've been living here for many years in the village of Zvezdets. And I'm very satisfied with Dr. Aneva because she comes over to our village regularly. We come for medical checkups regularly. So every Thursday, Dr. Aneva offers medical checkups, vaccinations, and the community is very happy to have a doctor here who is very close. They don't have to travel to the town of Malko Trnovo. And things are really working out great for everyone.
Надявам се, ще чуем.
I expect that we are going to hear more good examples from Dr. Stamenkova, who is going to be the moderator, and the other members of the panel. And also, you feel free to ask questions. We expect to have more time for this. Hello, everyone. The previous panelist mentioned that the best thing is to be a member of an afternoon panel. The difficult morning sessions were over. People have had lunch. It is hot outside, but here we are. Now we are going to prove that the last panel for the day will also be great. And this will happen because we are going to talk about health, and secondly, because the people who will talk to you and with you are very interesting. There are five of them, three women and two men. I'm going to invite the ladies first. The first one is the person who is the head of the project in the Plovdiv town and municipality. This is Sevjan Molabekir. She is the Plovdiv Nightingale, as I say. It's a great pleasure to interact with her because of her attitude, because of her ability to look forward and never forgets the importance of each and every person. The next lady I'm going to invite comes from the other part of the country, from the from the village of Ivanovsko-Shumen, and she is the good spirit of the Ivansky village. She is one of the newest health mediators. She proved herself as such in the network of health mediators. She became the person responsible for health mediation, but she is also involved in other areas. She will tell you more about her activities. Now, the gentleman, I'll start with my friend and a great participant in joke making, Tony Todorov, well known as the film character Tony Montana, because he comes from the town of Montana. This was a character in a movie, if I remember correctly. Just choose a seat. Next person to be invited is a person involved with an NGO. He's a part of the implementation of the health component of the project in Sliven. He works for Doctors of the World, and his name is Atanas Dimitrov. We see that applause is even raising, and last but not least, in terms of importance, is the person that I've known for the longest period. He works in the town of Montana. His name is Peter Cvetanov, and he's the first chair of the National Network of Health Mediators, right now a deputy chairperson of this network, very much involved in health issues and health mediation. I hope this will be interesting for you. Peter was the last to invite, but my questions will go first to him. So, Peter, can you tell us, because you have experience in with various projects and various formats in various locations. I remember when we first met, you worked in the town of Volchodrom. And now I'm going to ask you, within the framework of the ZOF program, what happened? What is the place and role of health mediation, and how health mediators made a difference in Montana, Dubrovnica, how they interact with the municipality and with the health experts and GPs. Hello, everyone. Thank you, Rada, for this question. In the beginning, I would like to repeat something which was already mentioned on several occasions, but as health mediator, I consider this important to be repeated. Last week, the Parliamentary Committee on Healthcare adopted at the second hearing amendments to the Health Act. And these amendments include formally the position of the health mediators. This is important because, and I am telling you this today, because it was the ZOF program which provided us health mediators and the health mediation institutional support. So the ZOF program is part of the history of the National Network of Health Mediators for development of health mediation in principle. I'm very happy and proud of it. This is a great step for health mediation in Bulgaria. And I would like to express my gratitude to all health mediators and to my colleagues who were directly involved in the implementation of the ZOF activities. Also, I want to thank all our supporters and a little gift, small gift for Mrs. Fayon and Mrs. Guneva. We have prepared here two photos. This is for Lily Guneva, so she would remember us forever. Thank you, Lily. Thank you for your support. The next photo, a landscape of Montana for Mrs. Fayon. So that you remember Montana forever. In brief, I'm going to tell you our story. The National Network of Health Mediators was, but you must be brief. Okay, I'll do my best. We were just part of a broad partnership team in 2012 in Montana. There was one health mediator. After that, there were three of us. But there was a point in time when the community had greater expectations from us, and we felt the frustration that we could not be helpful in some cases. At the same time, some issues that were within our remit were remained hidden and not addressed. The ZOF program helped us by promoting and enhancing the role of health mediators in the community through the health awareness campaigns, joint efforts with the doctors. All this gave us the right appearance in front of the community. Today, health mediators are well known in the community. The ZOF program also provided us with the opportunity to find many other supporters, same thinkers amongst the administration, the doctors community. Doctors now understand us much better. They are better aware of the challenges we face. And that's why there is increased trust between patients and doctors. In the end of the program, we organized an exhibition. It will be shown at public events of the National Network of Health Mediators. It shows our faces and the faces of our clients. Also, it shows the challenges and difficulties we encounter, but also the successes. And those of you who see the exhibition will also feel our satisfaction with what has been achieved. For me, it's very important that in the end of the implementation of the project in Montana Municipality, we see how the community has changed, how people can have greater dreams, because they understand that some of the problems can be, they can themselves solve some of the problems. As health mediator, I consider this very important, because we don't only want to assist the community, but also we want to develop it. Thank you. I'm a witness, a satisfied witness of how things have been developing in Montana. We have been working with you and with colleagues from Yamble and Sofia, and everybody who can observe your work thinks that Montana can be given as a good example, as a role model. As a person who communicates with various people, and I very often have to explain when I'm asked why you work with the gypsies. Can use you as an example. I can show photos of people cleaning their neighborhood, and suddenly they stop asking me these questions, because they understand that wonderful things can happen. Well, of course, maybe once you clean the neighborhood in a few days, you have to do it again, but that's everywhere, isn't it? But we start and we go on. Now we move on to our next panelist, Atanas, who works in a challenging environment called Nadezhda neighborhood. You've been working in this neighborhood for 10 years now. So what is the direction? Where is this neighborhood going? And how the ZOV program helped in this respect? And this from the standpoint of family planning and community outreach. I would like to thank the program first and foremost, because they helped us a lot. Where is Nadezhda neighborhood going to? Well, this is one of the biggest segregated neighborhoods on the territory of Bulgaria. Officially and unofficially, nobody can say how many people live there, but there are many. There are many problems as well, and very complex problem. I would like to hope, to believe that Nadezhda neighborhood is changing for the better. Many mothers of young children, once they enroll them to kindergarten, decided they would like to continue their own education, because they dropped out of school when they were 13 or 14 years of age. Many young families understand the importance of family planning and the benefits of this. Official statistics says that the abortion level in Sliven has gone down by 4 to 5% annually. I would like to believe that we also contributed to this. Steps are small. Changes are not that visible, because things are happening slowly. But if we did not believe in the positive change, we wouldn't have worked at all. The fact that health mediators are not recognized, and this will be a formal profession, is good. But being a health mediator, this is a talent, a calling. It's not an occupation. You must be a person who understands the needs of the community and does his or her best to help the people. However, it is also very difficult to keep your motivation, regardless of the great ideals based on the small remuneration and expanded expectations. If I understand you correctly, your expectations are for Nadezhda neighborhood to develop in the positive way. Last week we visited the neighborhood, we talked with colleagues of yours, and yes, we expect positive developments, but maybe this will happen after our life cycle, so to say. Well, probably you're right, but the soft program has sown a seed that will give fruit. We provided many children with the opportunity to study, also families to change. A great example of Nadezhda neighborhood is a girl who dropped out of school because she married at the age of 13. Now she has two children, but she decided to continue her education at an evening school. She graduated from a secondary school. Then she was admitted to the Varna Medical Institute, the branch in Sliven, and hopefully in a month from now we'll have a midwife in our neighborhood, and she will be the first person who have graduated in this field. I would like to ask the audience, has anyone visited the village of Ivansky? Raise your hands. Okay, so most of you have not been there ever. Well, this is a village in the Shumen region. For me, it is an example of how a program can change the agenda and the life of a small settlement. Also an example of how the right person can change the fate, the destiny of a settlement. There was a bone house close to the school called Money. So what does it mean to be a healthy mediator in a small settlement as the village of Ivansky? Good afternoon. I would like to start with some thank you words to Irina and Lily and the project management unit for being so flexible. Also, I'm grateful to the Shumen municipality and the project team, the program team, because they selected our village with ethnic minorities, Romas and Turks. Things developed in a very interesting way. For many years, this village has been in a very dilapidated state. Mayors did not pay any attention. The buildings were in bad need of repair. The health facilities as well. But thanks to the soft program, this dilapidated health center, which in the past was also maternity ward, was refurbished, and two doctor's offices were opened, so for obstetrics and pediatric office. Shumen municipality helped us a lot The population of the village now receives good specialized medical care and also equal access to health care, because before that these people did not even dare to dream about it. And several examples now. The personal stories are many, and they are good proof to the results achieved. There were young women, let's say 40 years of age, who never after giving birth in teenage age went to medical checkups. And it was obvious that the health culture of the population was very poor. People did not care about their own health. However, thanks to the program and the trainings and awareness campaigns and discussions, the health culture of the population improved, and the same people now feel responsible to their own health and to the health of their children. Also, now there are no children who have not been vaccinated, except for some who are abroad. And people who have not been to an obstetrics office, who did not know what to do, and now go frequent checkups, and the whole population is extremely grateful to the ZOV program and Shumen municipality. There is full coverage. All children are covered from in the age group 0 to 10 years. Also, there is social patronage offered to the youngest children 0 to 3 years of age. So there is new life in our village. I myself was surprised with this change in attitude, in the mindset. After completion of the program, thanks to the public awareness, now we have other doctors who offer such services free of charge, for example, a psychiatrist. I wondered how I can convince the people to go to such a specialist, to a psychologist, because I thought they would think that I would think about them that they were crazy. Well, maybe we all need a psychologist. So yes, I was surprised, and when I went over to inform the population about such medical checkup, people were happy. Nobody said, oh, do you think us crazy to offer such medical checkups? And I was pleasantly surprised, because when a woman who is illiterate says, well, yes, I need such an exam because there is too much stress, there are too many problems. This tells me that there are tangible results, and thanks to the health mediation and the field work under the ZOV program, people are now more aware and the results are positive.
I have another question. Apart from the fact that the Schumann municipality made it possible for Ivansky village to be included in the project, and apart from the Pawn House, all the rest of the other new developments were thanks to the ZOV program. And we were lucky that Irina came at the right time, at the right places. And to my knowledge, she's also an educational mediator half-time. And I realized that you were made a proposal. Would you like to share it? Because it's an example of how people can grow and their life changes, as it is, as the life of the midwife from Sliven changed. What do people in the village expect of you now? It's not exactly related to the topic, but if you are pressing me, I will say it. There were statements made that the Roma needed empowerment way before I came back from abroad. I worked in the NGO, and I know problems all too well, with all the pain. So it's in me to help out. So working under the ZOV program, a lot of new developments were experienced. Apart from resolving different cases as a health mediator, I became a family counselor, a psychologist, and Jane of all trades. But thanks to teamwork, a lot of things improved in this village, and people insisted on very much that I should apply for the position of a mayor. It's not a political formation, no. This has never been my ambition, but as they insist so much and said that they would vote for no one else, but if you apply, we will be there for you. So I consider it for a while, so, and I will be a candidate. It's also related to the Roma empowerment. It means that, Irina, by October, you should find inspiring people to replace you, to be your successors, because you're not going, you won't be able to act as a mediator afterwards, as mayor. And let me boast about another thing. Thanks to the ZOV program and the active interaction with a team, many children came back to school. Those that were at risk of dropout, those that had dropped out. There were isolated cases in of early marriages and hence dropouts. But thanks to discussions and meetings with the parents and with the authorities, they realized this mistake and got back to school. And thanks to the teamwork under the ZOV project, a lot of these kids are now graduating and continue studying in secondary schools. We even have a university student who studies management and economics in her second year. And there are also three other students studying on their own. They dropped out in the past. So if you want to grow, to develop, it's important to have the will and the desire to do so. Selo Ivansky, from Selo Ivansky to the European capital of culture. a difficult neighborhood as Tulipinovo, and a serious project being run in Plovdiv and Kuklin. What is your view as a municipal official? And a difficult question. The greatest challenge that we was related to health insurance. Have you got a proposal of what to do, and what was the most important thing that happened in Plovdiv? I know what happened in the yard of the outpatient care clinic. Good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to express my joy and gratitude for being part of the family. I remember one of the first meetings we had in Sofia, because we were one of the last municipalities to join in the last 2 years of the project implementation. Irina and Lily told us that we didn't know most of the people, but in a few years we will be a large family, and I must say that they kept this word, and I feel part of this family, because they were with us throughout, and I never made a difference between the representatives of different authorities. I would like to express my deep gratitude to the Bulgarian-Swiss cooperation program, to Irina, Lily, and Mr. Pithon. Thank you for making it possible to join in the project, even in the last moment. I hope we didn't disappoint you. For this short period of time, I'm proud to say that we managed to achieve almost 100% of the goals we had set out at the beginning. An advantage for the good results was the fact that, apart from PMU, the people that we worked with were also the ones to elaborate the concept for project proposal, and I thank them for working in a synchrony that nobody stepped backwards from this dedication. What are the results, Rada asked, Dr. Stamenkova asked. Apart from the healthcare center, which a year and a half ago was only a building that was meant for demolition, and we faced the challenge of the short timeline and the difficult public procurement procedures, we managed to finalize. So what about health insurance? What can be done? There is no magic wand, there is no crystal ball. Unfortunately, I can't give a solution, because it's a very complex issue. My experience indicates that if somebody needs surgery or admission, only then do people pay their health insurance contributions. Indeed, we have had some experiences where people ignored health insurance but changed their minds when they needed the services, and they now are members of the health insurance system. Of course, information and information awareness of health mediators, healthcare professionals, and personal example. So, do you feel sad, or do you feel relieved that the project is completing? Neither. I'm sad because it was only a very short time that we worked together. As a person with the experience in other projects. I must say that the last 6 or 7 months of a project are the most energizing and driving forward, and then we realize what else can be done, but then it's over. We are all aware that we can't do miracles in 2 years, but it's important to keep pushing. I think the foundation has been placed. It's only the beginning, and as Ms. Simeonova mentioned in the previous panel, we have a vision for the future based on experience and previous practices. We will continue to offer activities and services. Tony, now please do not thank anyone, but be very much to the point. And say what will be done after the project is over, so that the healthcare services could be offered through the central, through the social assistance services. Okay, no thanks from me then, if you insist. I suppose you've been tired of listening to statistics and quantitative information. I'll propose a quick overview from my point of view, not as an expert or project leader, but the point of view of a normal human being. What is so valuable in the ZOF program? It's not the numbers, it's not the checkups, nor the kids that learned how to read and write. The most valuable for me was the change. The change in attitude, the change in stereotypes and prejudice. Whether you're going to change the attitude of a non-Roma parent who disagrees with the fact that the several kids from the Roma neighborhood were enrolled in his or her class, or if you're going to change the attitude of a Roma woman who doesn't want to have an IUD in her because she will lose her hair or catch cancer. It's a two-way street. It's a change in attitude. Works both ways. So I wish we consider the accomplishment in an informally. A friend of mine tells me that that you're the only person, if you see a Bulgarian and Roma kids smoking together in the backyard. So this is the true inclusion. They both have accepted each other. Yes, but they defect, they cut classes together. But they cut classes together. They cut classes together, they sit in the cafe together, they are together. And we have seen this happening at celebrations, on festive days, when these are joint activities in the largest hall in Montana. And I look backwards too, and when I see the parents being happy at Roma dances and songs, I see this as the informal inclusion, and this is the core. It's easy to say these five kids are going to should go to a certain class, but informal inclusion is more important. Thank you. No, thank you. I will go on. We have to make a game with the audience. And as Mr. Gerasimov put it, systemic work as the, another valuable achievement of the ZOF program is the fact that these people that I was not supposed to thank, these people kept pushing us to make policies, not to work piecemeal, but look long term. And if we invest now, we would have the return in years multiplied. Thank you, Tom. Great. Bravo. Now we have Bojan Zakharyev, who will show us the quiz. Similarly, the same questionnaire as we had in the educational panel. Would you like the clicker? There are three slides only. One additional slide. We asked the 80 people, 80 responders, what the specificity of the ZOF program were, and meaning characteristics, but also features. And we insisted on the features because the finding is somewhat sad. 6 out of 10 responders said works in the most difficult neighborhoods with a high concentration of vulnerable groups. But as this is a feature, it means that there are no other programs that do the same, given that we have so many documents and European funds. This finding sounds good for the ZOF program, but it's sad for the state of play in as far as this policy is concerned. The second feature, 5 in 10 responded that this program combined health and educational interventions. It means that this is another pioneering work of this program. And further down, there are other options that were discussed, the soft measures combined with infrastructure. And one last thing, support and flexibility of the PMU. 3 out of 10 people indicated this being among the people that are experienced about the program, but there are other responders too, and I think this is gratitude again. It's a way of expressing gratitude. I just rephrase it because I keep my word. And as for healthcare, right to the point, based on your discussion.
Lack of health insurance has been mentioned by 4 in 5 people, 5 responders. Then lack of hygiene and low culture, and then lack of family planning, lack of money for medication, and insufficient number of health specialists working in Roma communities. These are all important issues. And who consider the system to blame, and who blame themselves? Well, answers are well. Some say that the lack of health contributions or health insurance is probably a systemic problem or problem of the system. I sometimes am not really sure what respondents, what exactly they think when they give such answers. And solutions, 3 in 10 say Well, we're sorry, but in the booth we cannot read the slides, and the person is not reading them. As an economist, the minimum package for the uninsured people and expand the insurance package is also important. We economists consider the cost of insurance, for example, based on what the person will lose. It is one thing if you lose a little bit of money from your bank account, and another thing if you cannot afford heating or food. Things are completely different. So that was all. Thank you, Bojan. Now we have some time. For you to ask questions and offer comments on the results that Bojan showed to us. Discussion time is always valuable. Ilona. I would just like to give a kind of retrospective answer to what we should do with the health insurance. As a sociologist, I've been observing this issue since 1999 or 2000, when, in fact, the health insurance system were launched. In 2004, we carried out a big representative survey regarding the attitude to the health system and health insurance. 18% of our respondents were uninsured, and 90% of them were extremely poor people. But at that time, it was possible to recover your health insurance right by paying us your contributions for 6 months. And until 2016, the health insurance fund would cover the work of the doctors provide and services provided to uninsured people. But after that, it was stopped. And then if you want to recover health insurance rights, you had to pay 12 months of fees. Later, we carried out another big nationally representative study. And these were in times prior to the crisis when there was employment, more or less. Still, at that time, uninsured people were represented 26% because of people being obliged to pay 12 months of contributions and not 6. Then these 12 months were increased to 24 months, and the share of uninsured raised to 30%. I think that 80% of them were from families at risk of poverty. There were few from the middle class and irresponsible people who just would not pay their health contributions. But those who were at risk of poverty and social exclusion, about 60% of them had a monthly income of less than 30 Bulgarian levs per capita. So you understand the issue. And I understand it when mothers tell me why their children would be absent from school mainly in winter. Now, if we want to recover insurance rights, we have to pay 60 months or 60 contributions, I'm sorry. It is almost impossible for some of these people to do this. The soft program, however, proved that it is possible to recover the situation. Some people started paying their contributions, sometimes because they needed an operation and they had it. They needed to have their insurance rights recovered. But there were also people who would work and still remain uninsured, although some say I've been working for 2 years and I'm still uninsured. So my idea is that we should not say with the next amendments that if you need to recover your insurance right, you have to pay 90 months. No, just the opposite. Let's go back to a shorter period or a smaller amount. Please introduce yourselves. Ivanka Jeva, National Network of Health Mediators. In continuation of what Professor Tomova said, I want to say that health mediators were the only people who organize and carry out campaigns regarding health insurance and that it is good for people to be insured. And thanks to this, more than 1,400 people have paid their insurance contributions in 2018. This is national, on the national level, according to health to reports provided by health mediators to the Ministry of Health. Something else regarding and in connection with the problematic health system, it is very difficult to create contacts between the health mediator and the medical experts, because usually the health mediator is a person from the neighborhood who goes to the doctor and tries to explain to him or her how to work with representatives of the communities. But that's what the health mediators have been doing. And there have been very good collaborations established. I see this because I'm engaged in internal monitoring. Doctors, in fact, are among the people who speak best about health mediators. So what we see is that problems with doctors who would not put vaccines. We have had such issues, we have had such cases, we have raised the issue with the Ministry of Health. We had such problem with a doctor who for years on end would not put the vaccines against measles. But now this person has changed. Sometimes, however, it takes years for change to become effective. Gabriela Kazakova from Doctors of the World. My question, I'm a nurse. I have maybe several questions, but my question is to the whole state, to the government, to all politicians, if possible. My question is, we're talking about health and education. and they come in one group. And this is not accidental, because we can expect to have a health spirit only in a healthy body, healthy spirit in a healthy body. However, the government looks in a more favorable way towards education and somehow neglects health. At least that's my impression. There are more educational programs, but education health is to a much greater extent connected with money. So what steps must be taken by the various organizations . What can be done so that a minimum package of minimum services is provided that would include preventive medical checkups and family planning, make the government recognize this as important, because health culture is of key importance. Because if education and health do not go hand in hand, it would not work. Dr. Panayotov from Sliven. I have an idea. How a certain group of people become insured, health insured group of people. I have about 500 patients, but 5,000, but 3,200 are uninsured. And every month, between 7 to 10 people would suddenly become insured. But in the age group 17 to 18, because after 18, that's a big group of 500 people would suddenly become uninsured. So some will become insured and others uninsured. Well, there is a smart way. Those who are 18 years of age, if they study, if they're regular students, they will be health insured until the age of 26. This is a smart move, would be a smart move on their part, wouldn't it? This is an example how to think out of the box. Albena Kostadinova, a chairperson of Indi Roma and a partner of Plovdiv municipality from the village of Kuklan. For 26 months, I have the pleasure to work with Plovdiv municipality. I want to express my satisfaction with the project. I'm grateful to the team of the Bulgarian-Swiss program, of the head of the project, of Zoya and many others, because they helped us a lot. They told us what to do and how to start. This project offered support to Roma women. Prevention is most important. Some women would go to an obstetrician in Plovdiv. And we had difficulty, in fact, to sign to a contract with an obstetrician, because when they understood that it was all about Roma women, they rejected us. Finally, a doctor agreed, although the women from Kuklan are not different from any other women. And with preventive medical checkups, some serious conditions were diagnosed, and if with carcinoma and tumors, and if it was not for this project, it would have not worked for them. So Professor Tomova said a lot on this issue, but I think that this policy of recovering rights is a kind of targeting the Roma population because they don't have permanent jobs. But we do not plan to give up. We gypsies are healthy, resilient people, and we can live without being health insurer. Thank you. But we are approaching the end of our panel, so one more question. We have thanked more or less to everyone. Tony? I did not expect anyone to give me the floor anymore. I'll be brief and fast. I have not prepared photos, drawings or anything. But do you know who is Hristo Prodanov? Hristo Prodanov, for the young ones and who do not know, is a Bulgarian hiker who 35 years ago conquered the peak of Everest without an oxygen mask on his own. Unfortunately, on his way back, he remained there forever. 35 years ago, before his expedition left for the Himalayas, he was a guest at one of TV shows, and the TV host had a logbook where a guest wrote messages. And Hristo Prodanov said, wrote there, wherever there is will, there is a road. That's why I wish you all to have the will to follow the road that you have chosen. Thank you, and I love you. I think nothing more can be said after these words of Tony's, although I heard in the lobby you have not prepared anything because you are very stingy. But I know this is not true. And now I would like to thank all the panelists, Petra, Nasco, Irina, Sevi and Tony. And let's leave the stage and give the floor for closing remarks to Mr. Roland Piton.
Ръководител на швейцарския офис на програмата.
Thank you. So, dear friends, I'm going to try to wrap up the day.
Скъпи приятели, аз ще се опитам сега да обобщя целия ден.
First of all, I want to say that we discussed today a lot of children going to school, I mean to preschool, kindergarten, after school, in a normal school with chairs. We discussed about mother, children going to the doctor to have some services, social inquiry about some problems. What? Why we need a conference? Because it's something normal, no? Isn't it normal that in many places, everywhere, children they go to school and mother they go to the doctor? I mean, why we have to talk one day about something which is normal, but it seems it's not normal for everybody.
И така, днес обсъждахме множество проблеми, свързани с това, че децата трябва да ходят на училище, трябва да ходят на детска градина, в предучилищна трябва да бъдат, че майките трябва да ходят на лекар, да бъдат преглеждани. Добре, защото ни е необходима конференция за да обсъждаме тези неща. Нима това не е нещо нормално, нали? Навсякъде децата ходят на училище, майките ходят на преглед. Добре, обаче се оказва, че след като цял ден го обсъждаме, значи не навсякъде е така.
So, I want to just repeat some of the achievement of the program that I already hear today. One, of course, that thanks to you, you managed to give possibility to more children to go to school, to more mother children to have access to the social and health services. So it's the first obvious, let's say, direct achievement of this program in 6 municipalities.
Ще се опитам така да повторя някои от постиженията на тази програма. Тези постижения, разбира се, са благодарение на всички вас. Благодарение на това, повече деца ще ходят на училище, на детска градина, повече майки ще имат достъп до различни здравни и социални грижи. И това се отнася за 6 общини.
And a second, I say, achievement, it was also said many times today, you know, is awareness within the community about how they have to take care of themselves, about importance to send the kids to school, awareness about the municipalities, the municipal administration, to take care about the community, also about the NGO. All these links, this trust, this also change, it was even said change in behavior, which is even more difficult. Everything was also achievements were done in that direction, which are not captured, let's say, by indicators, but it's very, very important result of this project.
Но освен това, много пъти днес беше повторено колко важно е създаването на връзки в общността и между общността, общините, администрацията. Това са връзки на доверие и също така стана дума за промяна в поведението. А поведението, както знаем, трудно се променя. С една дума, това е онази посока, в която се е тръгнало и то по един убедителен начин.
And the third achievement, I would say, is the project managed to make a link between the local, what happened at municipality in the community level, to the central, with the ministries, with the 3 ministries involved, by having direct contact, by inviting them to go on the spot, sharing the experiences. So it's very important exchange and information and also understanding what is going on the ground and vice versa, also how also the difficulties faced by the ministries to change things.
За предишното също така трябва да подчертая, че това са неща, които са ценни, но реално няма показатели, които да могат да ги отразят. И на трето място става дума за създаването благодарение и на проекта на връзки на между местните общности, между местното ниво и централното ниво. Факта, че вече имат директни такива връзки, посещение на място, обмяна на опит, запознаване с конкретната проблематика от една страна на местните общности, от друга страна предизвикателствата пред самите администрации, пред самите министерства.
And about the factor of success, why finally the program managed to achieve these things? The first, I would say, because from the beginning, we thought children going to school, mother going to the doctor, it's normal. So we try to say how it's possible that the municipality, that the health, the school, they just accept that it's normal. And this integration and this institutionalization within existing institutions, that was key of the success from the beginning. We thought how it's going to remain after when the project is at the end.
И сега ще спрем малко на факторите на успеха. Кои бяха те, за да постигнем това, което постигнахме? На първо място, от самото начало, бяхме наясно това, което вече казаха, именно, че е нормално, правилно децата да ходят на училище, майките да ходят на прегледи, всичко това, за което говорихме. От самото начало ние си казвахме, съвсем нормално е, така трябва да разсъждават общините, така трябва да разсъждават и училищата. Тази интеграция е нормален процес и ние подходихме по този начин. Въпрос е това да остане така.
Second, I would say factor of success is that this project, what happened in the municipality, all these actions, they were finally the result of proposal from the municipalities, from the local level, with NGOs, with the result of a dialogue, of a partnership, what is best for the municipalities, for the communities, and the program offers this flexibility to take into account this specific local situation.
На второ място, всички тези дейности по проекта бяха разработени въз основа на предложение на всяка община в партньорство с неправителствени организации, с местните власти. Изградиха се партньорства, на базата на които може да бъде преценено кое е най-добро за съответната община, за съответната общност, а проектът и предложи достатъчна гъвкавост за реализирането на тези дейности.
I think it was also important that thanks to the PMU and the organization of the working group with the ministries, we could have this dialogue with the central level. I mean, that the program from the beginning planned to have working groups with the ministry. It was a mechanism that also was important to make this bridge between local and national level.
Освен това, изключително важно беше, че заедно с звеното за управление на проекта бяха изградени тези работни групи към министерствата, които в процес на диалог действаха и решаваха проблемите. Това беше и важния механизъм, на който се основавахме и който използвахме, за да постигнем резултати.
Another factor is the length, I think about 5 years. It's good to have it's a long-term process, and for a donor it's more difficult to engage in long-term, and I think 5 years it's a fair duration for such a program. It's could be longer, of course, but normally they are much shorter.
Следващия фактор на успеха беше и самата продължителност на проекта, около 5 години. В крайна сметка това е сравнително дългосрочен период. Принципно за донорите е много по-трудно да се ангажират с дългосрочни проекти и 5 години мога да кажа, че е така един добър срок, добра продължителност, тъй като обикновено са доста по-кратки подобни проекти.
And the last, of course, probably the most important, are the dedication of the team, of the staff, of everybody of you. This willingness to go ahead, to make the change that are needed to improve the situation. I come later on that.
И разбира се, на последно място, но не по важност, е вашата отдаденост на всеки един от вас, на всички екипи, вашето желание да постигнете промяна. И заради това аз искам да ви изразя искрена благодарност.
About the still challenges, a lot of challenges were said today. I would just say I will much more focus on the program. One is about the quality. I mean, it's not just because the kids they go to school, to after school or to kindergarten that it's enough. They have to learn. So there's no discount for vulnerable groups. There's the same level of requirement. Otherwise, we miss the objective.
По отношение на предизвикателствата, много от тях вече бяха споделени и обсъдени. Аз ще обърна внимание на някои от тях от гледна точка на програмата. На първо място става дума за качество. Защото да, децата ще ходят на училище, на детска градина и така нататък, но най-важното е те да се научат, да бъдат подготвени. Защото не можем да правим отстъпки заради това, че това са деца от уязвими общности. Не, за всички трябва да има това качество.
Because also we want that the education and also the health to benefit from them. And one of the factors is of course access to the job. And it's probably one of the challenge is to make the link between education and job. And for that, the level of education, I mean the quality of education is very important if you go before going after to the next step to make a bridge with the possibility of getting a job.
В крайна сметка, често говорим за тази връзка между образованието и работата, пригодността за работа. Искаме да осигурим равен достъп до пазара на труда. Но за да може това да бъде постигнато, на първо място, преди това става дума за качеството на самото образование. И само тогава ние ще можем да изградим мост между образованието и заетостта.
A lot of challenges were mentioned today, like about family planning, linked family planning, access to health without health insurance, all these issues. But at least I think the program managed to offer a platform of discussion, a connection between your problem you encounter with the people from the policy level.
Други предизвикателства, които бяха също обсъдени днес, са свързани с семейното планиране, с достъпа до здравна грижа, на здравното осигуряване също. Не можем да кажем, че са решени тези проблеми, но смятам, че програмата предложи платформа за дискусия и възможност тези проблеми да бъдат чути и на други нива.
So we see with this program that even the law is inclusive for education, for health, is not enough. You need special measures in order that this law really benefits to everybody. And for that, measures, but to have measures, you need really commitment and willingness to have the things done. It was said many things at the municipal level, but also the resources and the possibilities should also come from the central level. I think it's a joint effort from each and every level. But my conclusion when we discussed this program 10 years ago, 2009, and now, I mean, we see a big difference in terms of willingness to work together.
Защото това, което стана ясно и по тази програма е, че да, законът предоставя принципно равен достъп, то е включващ, но това не означава и не е достатъчно. Необходими са мерки, които да гарантират спазването на и прилагането по този начин. Необходим е ангажимент от страна на общините, на централно ниво, на всички нива, както разбира се и ресурси, за да може да се постигне това, което принципно е разписано в закона. В крайна сметка, като лично заключение, мога да кажа, че днес, 10 години по-късно, от когато наблюдавам процеса от 2009 година, виждам голяма разлика в желанието за сътрудничество, за обща работа.
So, thanks a lot to you, to the member of the community, member of the municipality, the NGOs, all the experts that worked for this program, very important to make changes at local level.
Затова сега искам да ви благодаря на всички вас, на представителите на общностите, на общините, на неправителствените организации, на всички експерти, които работихте активно, на здравните, образователни медиатори, тъй като вие правите възможен този процес.
Thank you also people, expert authorities from central level that were interested in the program, try also to make their contribution.
Благодаря също така на представителите на централните власти, които имаха голям принос в реализирането на програмата.
And of course, thank you to the team of the PMU, Project Management Unit. Thank you from the team of the embassy. I speak here about Irina and Lily. Thank you very much. Thank you, Daniela. And also thank you for expert Docho that guide us during from the beginning, already 10 years ago up to today, with the concept, with his critical eye on the development of the program. Thanks a lot. We know that the success is also thanks to your hard work.
Разбира се, искам да благодаря и на екипа, на звеното за управление на проекта, на посолството. Става дума конкретно за Ирина, за Лили, за Даниела. Благодаря също така и на Дочо за това, че ни направляваше и ни помагаше през всичките тези години и спомогна ни за разработването на тази концепция. Смятам, че каквито успехи да отчитаме днес, те се дължат на усилията на всички.
So this project is not a project, in fact, is to give hope, to give opportunities, to give a chance to young people, new generation, to the families, to have a better future. It's not about a project, it's about life of people, so we don't have to play with that. You manage to improve the situation of many of them and to give also a chance for others to have a benefit from your work in the future. And on this aspect, maybe later we'll have a great tennisman from Bulgaria, because a small kids wanted to be tennisman, I heard. I think you can be proud of your job, because it had an impact of many life of kids also and families. From this country. Thank you very much.
И в крайна сметка това не е проект заради самия проект. Това всичко е свързано с надеждата, с възможностите, с един нов шанс за младите хора, за младото поколение, за семействата, шанс за по-добро бъдеще. Да, по проекта успяхме да помогнем да се подобри положението на много хора, но се надяваме, че за в бъдеще това ще бъде шанс и за много други. Вероятно този резултат, този ефект ще видим на един по-късен етап и да се надяваме, че той наистина ще се случи и ще бъде видим. Смятам, че всички трябва да се гордеете с вашата работа и с постигнатото от вас.
И така, приятели, след всички хубави примери, които се дадаха днес, и както каза, така ще продължа Тони Монтана, където има воля, има път, но без смях и забавление не става, така че ви каня на едно тайно място. Автобусите тръгват след 50 минути, в 18:45 пред хотела. Така че ще имаме възможност и на още по-приятна атмосфера да коментираме днешния ден. Така че до вечера. Аплодисменти за всички.